Okay, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the defense of my thesis entitled Hydrophobization of Cellulose for Bio-based Materials. Well, I believe that everyone attending this defense already very familiar with cellulose. So instead of introducing what is cellulose, I would like to begin with the history of cellulose. In 1838, cellulose was first discovered by a French chemist. And in 1845, natural cellulose, as you know, the raw material for explosives, was invented. And after several decades, there was a milestone. The so-called first industrial plastic celluloid was invented by a company invested by the famous American inventor, John Hutt. And after several decades again, commercial products like rayon cellulose were invented one by one. But late until 1920, the structure of cellulose was finally determined. It is very interesting to find that the time gap between cellulose was first discovered until the structure was determined was almost as long as a century. But even without knowing the structure of cellulose, it didn't stop people to modify cellulose to acquire new properties. That is because the structure of cellulose can definitely be able to be changed, or more precisely, the hydroxyl groups on cellulose can be partially or fully reacted to acquire new properties. Here I give some classic examples for modification of cellulose. For example, through esterification, we can prepare cellulose triacetate, which is kind of film-forming agent and also used in my project. And we can also prepare nitrile cellulose, as I mentioned in previous slide. And by the esterification, we can prepare cellulose, methyl cellulose, hydroxyl cellulose, carboxymethyl cellulose, and those can be used in coating areas or be used as forming agent. And but I want to say is that here in our study, we focus on one branch of modification of cellulose, that is the hydrophobization. And as the name suggested, hydrophobization sounds like our work has to be developing some water repellent product. And yes, indeed, we prepared water repellent textiles. But what I want to say is that the hydrophobization, including but not limited to develop water repellent products, it is also very important in preparing composites, especially when cellulose and some other thermoplastic polymers like PP or PE were involved. Although in the whole procedure, water is not involved at all. And the reason is that the compatibility between cellulose and PP is quite poor. We usually believe that cellulose is kind of hydrophilic and PP is kind of hydrophobic. Therefore, we need to find some way to hydrophobize cellulose to increase the interfacial adhere between these two faces so that when the composite was subject to a mechanical force, the force can be smoothly transferred from one face to the other one. And in my study, we used two different kinds of coupling agent. In the first paper, we used maleic anhydride graft polypropylene, or abbreviated as MAP. And in the second one, we used oleic acid. There was a common point. As you can see, all of them has a reactive group which can be reacted with cellulose. And on the other hand, it has a long fatty chain which can be fit with the surrounding PP matrix very well, so that we can expect a very good interfacial adhesion between PP and the cellulose. And actually, the cellulosic filler that used in our study are not exact cellulose, actually, but instead it's a kind of new species of cellulosic derivatives called cellulose oxalate. It was prepared by our previous colleague 3 years ago, and the method is we treat wood pulp fiber with molten oxalate acid dihydrate at 110 degrees to cause a concurrent hydrolysis and esterification for around 15 minutes. And we found that the appearance of cox is very much like normal pulp. And from a microscopic perspective, we found that the size of cox is very much like microcrystalline cellulose. So I would say, so that's why in our study, we also included MCC as a kind of reference for the comparison purpose. And usually we believe that cellulose is kind of combination of amorphous region and the crystalline region. And the ratio between these two parts largely determines its property. Because conventionally we believe that the crystalline region is kind of stiff but less reactive. And the amorphous region is kind of to the opposite. And here in our study, the ratio is extremely important because we need to have sufficient crystalline region to do the reinforcing work. And on the other hand, we need to have some amorphous region to be reacted with the map. So in this study, we use the ball milling machine to change that ratio. And we treat our COX and MCC for 3 different times, 1 hour, 4 hour, and 8 hours. And here are some results from different characterization methods. That's from left to right. In the left is the SEM images. We found that the original COX and MCC are very much like a cylinder shape with a length of around, I would say, 50 to 100 micrometer. But after 1 hour of milling, both the size and the aspect ratio become smaller. And after 4 hour and 8 hour, the size and the aspect ratio remains almost unchanged. So I would say the effect of ball milling mainly happened during the first hour. And in the middle is the FTIR spectra. You cannot find very much pronounced changes for the curves with increasing milling time, but some tiny changes can be identified. For example, the original MCC has 2 inflection points at around 3,300, but with the increase in milling time, the intensity of those 2 peaks become less intensive and the peak become broader. That is because the ball milling collapses the hydrogen bond and release more free hydroxyl groups. But the structure of cellulose still remains as cellulose 1 beta, as can be identified with those characteristic peaks in the fingerprint region. And compared with MCC, not too much difference in COX can be found, except the bands at around 1,744 that corresponds to the carbonyl stretching. That is because we have a lot of carboxyl groups and ester bond in the COX. So that's why here will be a peak. And the rightmost is the XRD patterns. We can see that the original MCC and the COX shows crystalline structure with a crystallinity index of around 60%. But after 1 hour of milling, the MCC has become very amorphous and the CI is not detectable. But after 1 hour of milling, the CI of COX is still detectable as around 44%. And after 4 hour or 8 hour of milling, both MCC and COX are too amorphous, so there was no CI detectable. And as I said before, we expect reaction between MAP and either COX or MCC. So we mix them with the mass ratio of 1:3, use this twin screw mini excluder, and we mix it. And after mix it, we extract the mixture, use Soxhlet extractor to remove those non-bounded MAP and send the residues to FTIR to verify the success of reaction. And here, the figure A and B stands for a magnified FTIR spectra with a focus on the carbonyl band. And all the bands were normalized. So I would say the higher the peak, the more the carbonyl bonds. And you will find that with the increasing milling time in both cases, the bands become higher and higher because we have more and more hydroxyl groups to be reacted. And you may also find with the same milling time, the COX-based material shows a higher band than the MCC-based ones. But I have to say that this is not the evidence for comparing the extent of esterification, because as I mentioned before, we have a lot of inherent carboxyl groups and the ester bond in the COX. So we have to focus on another area of the IR. And that was from 3,000 to around 2,800 that corresponds to the alkane stretching. Because once MAP was attached to COX or MCC, the PP segment on MAP will give us some signals on FTIR spectra. And that's why if you compare the C with D, you will find the bands in D are like more winding. And those winding bands were caused by the attached PP segment. And the last step is to prepare a tensile bus. We pre-mixed PP with our mixture with a mass ratio of 3:2. Which also means the mass ratio of PP to MAP to the cellulose filler is 6:1:3. And we send the mixture to the mini injection motor to prepare a standard tensile bus, which will be subsequently subject to tensile tests. And here's the results. We have the results of tensile strength, Young's modulus, and the elongation at break. And except our samples, we also prepared a lot of reference samples. For example, the blue mark stands for the pure PP, and the pink mark stands for only PP and the MAP. The green mark stands for only PP and MCC, and the yellow mark stands for only PP and the COX. There are a lot of findings that corresponds very well with previously already proven phenomena like the PP shoulder necking behavior. So that's why its elongation at break is far higher than the other samples. And after adding either COX or MCC into the PP, the Young's modulus becomes higher and the tensile strength becomes lower. But after adding MAP into it, both the Young's modulus and the tensile strength become higher. If you compare the black mark with the green mark or compare the red mark with the yellow mark, you will find it. But those are old findings, not something new in our study. And something new in our study is that we found that with increasing mating time, COX is a more promising material than MCC, because generally you will find that the red lines above the black line. And with the increasing mating time, the MCC-based composite shows a decreasing tensile properties. And what is interesting is that the COX-based composite should first increase and then decrease property. Especially at milling hour of 1 hour, it gives us the best sample. And the reason for that is we believe that maybe 1 hour of milling is kind of very ideal milling time. And during that time, we still have sufficient crystalline region remaining. But in the meanwhile, we created enough amorphous region to be reacted with MAP. But after 4 hours or 8 hours milling, the milling might be too harsh to destroy, so that all the crystalline region were destroyed. And this is case in MCC. After 1 hour of milling, maybe already a lot of crystalline region were destroyed. So it cannot play a role of reinforcing anymore. But what is the exact optimized CI and what time will lead to that CI is still unknown, and that needs to be carried out in the further study. And in the next project, we also prepared composite with PP and hydrophobic COX. But this time we decided to replace MAP with oleic acid. And there are several reasons to choose this chemical. The first one is from a structure perspective. It is feasible because it has a hydroxyl group which can be reacted with COX, and it has a long fatty chain which can be fit with the PP very well. And the second reason is that it's a renewable and biodegradable material, so why not use it? But the most important is the third reason. That is something to do with the catalyst, because usually if we want to hydrophobize a normal cellulose like MCC, we need to use toxic catalysts like pyridine, like toluene sulfonyl chloride, to perform the reaction. But here we notice that this is might be a Fischer, a classic Fischer esterification, which can be acid catalyst. And in the COX, you know that we have the inherent carboxyl groups, and this may play a role of catalyst. So we are wondering, is it possible to avoid using those toxic catalysts? So in this project, we react COX or MCC with oleic acid for three different times, 6 hours, 18 hours, and 48 hours. And here are some results from degree of substitution and the contact angle. We found that generally the DS is very low, but with increasing milling times, both COX and MCC showed increasing degree of substitution. And the increasing speed of COX is higher than the increasing speed of MCC. That is because there was no catalyst. The reaction between MCC and the oleic acid is very much limited. And maybe 6 hours is too short, so there was no contact angle detectable. But after 18 or 48 hours, the reacted COX showed detectable contact angle of around 130 degree. And after 48 hours of reaction, the MCC showed a detectable contact angle of around 137. But I would say only very limited position of the surface of sample showed detectable contact angle. As I remember, only 3 or 4 positions. And for the other positions, once you place the water droplet onto it, it will be absorbed into the surface. So I would say it's not uniform at all. And again, we use IR to verify the success of reaction. For the right figure, you will find that there was no band at all at the peak at 1750, which should be corresponds to the carbonyl group. So there was no reaction. And yes, in the left figure, you will find the peak at 1750. And as I already said, this cannot be used as evidence because we have inherent lot of carbonyl groups. But we can focus on the band at around 2900. We found that after 6 hours of reaction, the single peak was turned to double peak, and those double peak may be caused by the attached oleic acid. And the last step is, again, preparing the materials. And we tested the tensile strength, Young's modulus, and the elongation at the break. We mixed PP with our hydrophobic cellulose with a mass ratio of 9:1. We found that with the increasing reaction time, generally the tensile properties was increased in both cases. And we find that COX is a more promising material, a more promising filler than MCC, because the black line is generally higher than the red line. So through this study, we demonstrate that it is definitely possible to avoid using toxic catalysts to prepare the fillers to use in the composite. And because there are more oleic acid was attached to the MCC, to the COX, it will give it a more hydrophobic surface, and therefore a better interfacial adhesion can be expected. And so because there was no toxic catalyst, it allows the whole procedure to be environmentally friendly. And similarly, by taking environmental issues into account, we also used natural compounds instead of synthetic ones to prepare hydrophobic textiles. And the natural compound that we used is called betulin. In the left figure, I give you a birch forest. If you have ever wondered why the birch trees are white in color, that is because of betulin. Betulin, coming from the Latin name betula, that meaning birches, and it only existed in the outer bark of birch. And if you look at the structure, it's kind of tritopine, and it is very unsubstantifiable. So I would say it's not something good in the paper industry. So that's why after logging wood from forest, the wood needs to be debarked to be sent to the pulp mills. Otherwise, it will cause some problems. But what to do with those barks then? Usually nowadays, we just burn it to provide some more energy. But according to the value, the biomass value pyramid, I would say burn the biomass as a kind of solid fuel is very low value application. So we were wondering if we could extract betulin out and turn into some materials or polymers to increase its value. And due to the hydrocarbon skeleton of betulin, we believe it's kind of hydrophobic and can be used in hydrophobization process. So the concept is very simple. After collecting the birch bark, we extracted it using succinic extraction, and we apply three different methods to introduce betulin onto the cotton textile to give it a hydrophobic property. The first method has to be the simplest and the most straightforward method, the deep coating method. We prepared betulin solutions with different solvents and different concentrations, and use a deep pet dry cure process to ensure that the cylinder-like betulin particles was adhered onto the textile fibers. And such prepared textile already showed very high contact angle of 153 degree. And the second method is the film coating method. As I mentioned before, cellulose triacetate is a kind of film forming agent. So by using this one, we prepared betulin-based film and coated it onto the textile to prepare new material. And here's the cross-section you can see. And such prepared material showed a water contact angle of 123 degree. And we also test its water repellency used a standard spray test by using this kind of device. And after spraying and compare it with the standard rating chart, we found that the score is kind of 80. So not bad, I would say. And we also prepared betulin-based cool polymer with the TEFS loyal chloride. As you can see, the absence of hydroxyl group and the presence of the carbonyl group, the success of reaction was verified. And we also characterized it with ZEC and DSC. Here are some parameters. And instead of using betulin monomers, we used the cool polymers in the previous method, deep coating and film coating again. And here we found that the morphology of the cool polymer is much like thin slices that are covering the surface of textiles. And such prepared film coated material showed a contact angle of around 102, 104 degree and has a standard water spray test score of 80 as well. But we are chemists. We are not satisfied with only physically adhere betulin or betulin-based particles onto the textiles. So we are wondering if we could chemically graft betulin onto a textile, to give it a more stable structure. And the concept is we first create a surface carboxyl functionalized contact there, and then ethify bitolene onto it. The oxidation that we used is temporal mediated oxidation, and the esterification that we used is a tartaric acid catalyst esterification. And we apply three different times of oxidation, 15 minutes, 45 minutes, and 3 hours. And the success of oxidation was easily to be verified, as you can see the obvious peak at 1727. And with the increasing oxidation time, the carboxyl group content and the degree of oxidation was also increased. But there was an issue to verify the success of esterification with only IR because the band of east bond and the carboxyl groups were generally overlap with each other. So we need to find a way to differentiate one of them to expose the other one. And the method that we used is we treat our sample with sodium hydroxide solution with very low concentration at room temperature for a very short time to convert those carboxyl groups into the carboxylate groups. And in the meanwhile, we should avoid the hydrolysis of ester bond. And since we apply three different times of esterification as well, 6 hours, 1 day, and 3 days, so totally we have three times three, totally 9 samples, and the ester bond was clearly exposed. So I will say the esterification was verified. And here are some SEM images from our sample of each step. Figure A stands for a reference or original cotton, and the figure B stands for the one after oxidation, and the figure D of the stands for the one after esterification. And the figure D stands for the one of an original textile that dipped into betulene solution in toluene, because the esterification was carried out in toluene. And we found that the morphology of betulene particles in toluene is also cylinder-like. This is very important because in the figure C, you will find that because after esterification, we washed our sample in salt lake extraction to remove those non-attached betulene particles. And you can see there was no cylinder-like betulene particles adhered there anymore. So I would say if the sample in C shows some properties, and those properties can be attributed to the grafted betulene molecules, but not those non-attached betulene particles. And we measured the contact angle. Only 3 of our samples showed very stable and detectable contact angle. And those are the ones with longest oxidation and esterification, so that makes some sense. And since the surface of textile is kind of rough, the combination of the roughness and the low surface tension of betulene will generally lead to a hydrophobic property. And as reported, betulene has a lot of antimicrobial properties, like antifungi, antibacterial, antivirals. Not sure for coronavirus though, but here we did an antibacterial test. We did 2 kinds of antibacterial tests: bacterial reduction without adding any nutrients, and the bacterial growth inhibition with the presence of nutrients. We had 2 kinds of bacteria, gram-positive areas and the gram-negative E. coli. We select 3 different samples from each oxidation time to do the test, and here's the result. The left one stands for the result of bacterial reduction without adding any nutrients. The leftmost chart is a pass control group, which means without adding anything. And the right one stands for the group adding an original textile. It's very interesting to find that the remaining amount of viable bacteria of this one is not less than this one, but in reverse is higher than this one. And we guess it might be because the textile itself is a kind of polysaccharide, and it can be served as a kind of nutrients. So that's why the bacteria will grow. And for our samples, it shows quite good antibacterial property, especially the one underwent 3 hours of oxidation and 1 day of esterification showed bacterial reduction over 99% against both type of bacteria. And the right figure stands for the bacterial growth inhibition with the presence of nutrients. We found that since this time we have the nutrients, so the remaining amount of bacteria of the plus control group and the reference control group is not that big as the left one. And again, the sample underwent 3 hours of oxidation and 1 day of esterification, showed quite significant bacterial growth inhibitory effect with a bacterial reduction up to 99.9%. So finally, we can make a conclusion that the hydrophobization of cellulose, including but not limited to prepare hydrophobic products. In the first two articles, we found that COX is a more promising material than MCC. And 1 hour of bone mineral will give us the best results. And it is also possible to avoid using toxic catalyst to prepare the hydrophobized COX in order to use in the used as cellulose filler in the composite. And in the third and the fourth article, we know that the battling such kind of side stream product in paper industry can be used in value-added application instead of being burnt. The battling or battling-based copolymer of the films based on the monomer or copolymer can be adhered onto the textile to give it hydrophobic property. And the battling can also be grafted onto the textile to give it hydrophobic property and the antibacterial property. But there are a lot of work to do in the future. For example, we know that 1 hour is the best result so far, but what is the ideal bone mineral time is still unknown, and then we need to find it out. And the durability of the prepared textile is also very important. And right now we know it's kind of antibacterial, but we're not biologists. So what's the specific antibacterial mechanism is still unknown and needs to be carried out. And due to the oxidation and esterification, the DP of cellulose might be decreased and it will cause a loss in the mechanical property. So how to preserve that is also a topic that was discussing in future. And last, I'd like to thank my department, wood chemistry, my department, and especially my division, wood chemistry and popular technology, for providing us such an amazing atmosphere for study and research. I also want to thank my supervisors, Professor Yek and Dr. Li, and the co-authors, Dr. Chen and Ms. Kwan, for their constant help. And I also want to thank Foundation CSC, Wallen Bai Foundation, and OFOSC for their financial support. And last but not least, I want to thank my parents. I know they are watching online. Yeah, that's all. Thank you.